Good evening, church. Welcome to the organized chaos that is tonight. Did you guys pay extra to see the sound check? Because I think that's how that works. You have to have like backstage passes to be able to see that. So I better see some royalties coming my way, is all I'm saying.
Don't hold your breath.
Man. Well, I guess Bob's getting them. I just want to share. Well, I'm excited to worship tonight, guys. I think the songs that I was led to choose are all really good, and I'm excited to play them. And they're super worshipful, and I'm hoping that you guys all feel the same. So let's just open with a word of prayer here. God, we just want to invite you into this room with us. Send your Holy Spirit and just speak to our hearts throughout the worship and throughout the message, Lord. We want to hear your voice. We don't want to hear any ideas from man, because we've seen history can tell how that goes. So we want you, Jesus, and nothing else. We pray in your name. Amen. Walking around these walls, I thought by now they'd fall, but you have never failed me yet. Waiting for change to come, knowing the battle's won, for you have never failed me yet. Your promise still stands, great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. I'm still in your This is my confidence. You never failed me yet. And I know the night won't last. Your word will come to pass. My heart will sing your praise again. Jesus, you're still enough. Keep me within your love. My heart will sing your praise again. Your promise still stands, great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. I'm still in your hands, this is my confidence, you never fail. Your promise still stands, your promise still stands, great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. This is my confidence, you never failed me yet. Thank you.
You'll move the mountains, and I believe I'll see you do it again. You made a way where there was no way, and I believe I'll see you do it again. I've seen you move. You move the mountains, and I believe I'll see you do it again. You made a way where there was no way, and I believe I'll see you do it again. Still stands. Great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never fail. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. Still in your hands, this is my confidence. You never failed me yet. You've never failed me yet, and I never will forget, 'cause you never fail.
What a powerful song. He never fails. His promise always stands. Even when we don't see it. I think back to like even coming to Colorado. Even when I couldn't see it, his promise stood and I was in his hands the whole way. And I got here and he had everything all set up and ready to go. I was so worried the whole time. But he had it, and all I had to do was just trust him. And if he can do that for me, he can do it for you guys as well. We're in his hands. I've seen him move the mountains, and I believe I'll see him do it again. He's not done. He's still working. It's not done until we're all in the clouds with him. What a great day that will be, huh? Amen. That's kind of what this next song is about. That was an awesome segue. Good job, Caleb.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Of salvation, purchase of God, born in his spirit, washed in his blood. 'Cause this is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day. Perfect submission, perfect delight. Visions of rapture now burst in my sight. Angels descending bring from above echoes of mercy, whispers of love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, all is at rest. I and my Savior am happy and blessed, watching and waiting, looking above, filled with His goodness. Lost in His love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Praising my Savior all the day long.
Amen. I grew up in like a Wesleyan church, like smaller than this church. And so I sang hymns all throughout my childhood, and I hated them. I'm like, this isn't Switchfoot. What is this? This sucks. There's no guitars. But I went through a long period of time where I was like, hymns are bad. We don't sing those. But within the past, like, 6 years, I'd say, I've just come to love them. They're so beautifully written. And they're so intimate. And there's a few songs like that nowadays, but there's just something about them. People seemed to be so in touch with the Spirit and with God back then. And not that we're not now, just in a different way back then. They didn't have technology like we do, right? So what better thing do you have to do than write a sweet hymn to the Lord, you know? That being said, we're going to sing two more hymns. We're going old school tonight, baby.
I surrender all to Him, I freely give. I will ever love and trust Him in His presence daily live. Surrender, make me Savior, holy thy Holy Spirit fill me. May I know that thou art mine. And I surrender all. Surrender, Lord, I give myself to thee. Fill me with thy love and power. Let thy blessing fall on me. And I surrender all. And I surrender. Surrender all, and I surrender all to thee, my blessed Savior. I surrender all to Jesus. I surrender. His feet I bow, worldly pleasures I'll forsake and freely give myself to thou.
Sing it out to him right now.
And I surrender all. And I surrender.
More time.
And I surrender all. And I surrender all. And all to thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender all. Thou, O Lord, on high above all the earth, thou art exalted far above all gods. For thou, O Lord, on high above all exalted far above all gods.
Come on, lift his name up.
And I exalt thee. I exalt thee. I exalt thee. Oh,
lift your voices to him.
And I exalt thee. And I exalt thee. I exalt thee.
Jesus, we truly do exalt thee. We lift your name above all other names, Jesus. There is no name greater than yours. What a beautiful name it is, Jesus. We know you are with us, Lord. We know we have your Holy Spirit. And we know that this church is filled. This church is filled and ready to serve Jesus. So we just pray that you give us direction, Lord. Because we can't do anything without you. That is how great you are and how small we are, Lord. As we come to this Easter season, Lord, it's just on Sunday. It's right around the corner. We really want to hammer in the fact that you are God. You're not just some man who came and taught a few things, Jesus. Because if that were true, you wouldn't be a good teacher. You would be a madman. No one would claim to be those things if it was not true, Jesus. Without your death and resurrection, you were just a man, but you proved to us that you are God, and you have authority over all things, Lord. And for that, we love you, and we praise you, and we lift your name up. In your name we pray, amen. You want to take a few moments to say hi to everyone and greet each other.
Well, good evening, everybody. Thank you. I appreciate that. Go ahead and find your seat. We're going to get going. If you have your Bible, please crack it open to 1 Samuel chapter 1. Oh, I'm even louder now. I was on before, but now I'm really on. I'm tired today. I'm going to ask for your grace in my fatigue. Maybe you're feeling it. Maybe it was a long day for you as well. Yeah. There is a little bit of feedback. It's They're on it. Appreciate it. Well, just as a small, very, very, very brief recap, we did an introduction to the book last week. We covered the first 8 verses, and a lot of that was just talking about the background, not only of the book, but of Samuel himself and giving the backdrop to his ministry. Samuel is the last judge that is going to rule over the nation of Israel, and God uses him as a key transitional figure to where Samuel is going to be the one who anoints Israel's first king. And so we going from a time of being ruled by judges to kings into the monarchy here. And so verses 1-8 was basically just leading up to Samuel's birth. And we're going to pick that story up about Hannah going over to the tabernacle and just all the events that transpire into that. And then we'll even peek into chapter 2 a little bit tonight. I told you last week I was going to try to do that. And we're not going to cover all of chapter 2, but we are going to jump into it a little bit. So let's just have a moment of prayer, and then we'll start reading verses 9 through 11. Heavenly Father, I thank you for the opportunity to gather brothers and sisters in Christ, to gather around your word, to have your word without persecution, to even have the Bible translated in so many languages. Lord, you've revealed yourself to us through the pages of Scripture. And Lord, I just pray that your Holy Spirit would be very present with us tonight to just illuminate your word to our hearts, giving us an accurate interpretation. And by your Spirit, would you just apply it to the areas of our life and the ways that you know that we need to be led. We want to hear your voice. We want to know how to follow you. We want to know how to respond in obedience. And so, Lord, please fill me with your Spirit to enable me to teach and help me to teach accurately the historical and biblical context of things. But, Lord, would you move in even a prophetical way? Lord, we want to hear you speaking and ministering to us. And so build us up to change us to be more and more like Christ. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, let's start off with verses 9 to 11. It says, "Then Hannah rose after eating and drinking in Shiloh. Now Eli the priest was sitting on the seat by the doorpost of the temple of the Lord, and she, greatly distressed, prayed to the Lord and wept bitterly. She made a vow and said, 'Lord of hosts, if you will indeed look on the affliction of your maidservant and remember me, and not forget your maidservant, but will give your maidservant a son, then I will give him to the Lord all the days of his life, and a razor shall never come on his head.'" And so maybe you remember from last week where Elkanah and his family had arrived in Shiloh. They were making their pilgrimage. They were celebrating one of the 3 required pilgrimage feasts, most likely Passover. Can't say for 100% certain. And his wife Peninnah had multiple sons and daughters. And then his other wife Hannah, presumably his first wife, was barren. She had no children. And so there was the part of the sacrifice that was given to the Lord, part of the sacrifice given to the priest, part of the sacrifice that the family got to share in, a very honorable thing to partake in your worship. And he gave Hannah an extra portion, just trying to minister to her, trying to bless her, knowing the affliction that she's faced from the culture, the affliction that she's faced from her rival, you know, Peninnah, the other wife. And Elkanah just trying to reassure her in love. But his kind gesture didn't seem to help, because in verse 7, it says that she still wouldn't eat. So she's still heartbroken. She's still distressed over all this. And now here in verse 9, it picks up pretty much as soon as dinner was over. She heads out to go for prayer, literally to go cry out to the Lord. And we're also at this point in the story introduced to Eli the priest. He's sitting on his seat by the doorpost of the temple. And if you remember, we talked last week about how the actual temple with stone wasn't built just yet. The place in the center for worship was the tabernacle, the tent. The temple was built later on. And so at this point, when it says that he's, you know, there in the temple, it's synonymous here with that tabernacle and that doorpost of the tabernacle. If you want to put a little picture of it, courtesy of YouTube, you know, a nice little rendition here. I just took a screenshot of it. Those curtains into the courtyard there is the wooden doorpost, and that's where Eli would have been sitting, right in that vicinity, really sitting down in the seat of authority. He would have been able to sit and oversee some of the work that the other priests were doing. He would have been able to monitor people, you know, coming and going and praying, and just to be there to minister, to help out. And so it's there at that front of it that you saw where Hannah's crying out to the God, making her vow that if she would just be able to receive a son from the Lord, that she would even dedicate her son back to God, and the son would be his all the days of his life. And so she's crying out to the Lord, and this is a very selfless prayer if you think about it. Because if you think back into her history, she's been barren for so long, and she has really been the object of ridicule for so long, that you would think if God was to give her a son, the natural maternal instincts and everything would kick in, and she's like, I probably want this son next to me and in the home as long as I possibly can. You know, he's going to get married, and they're going to live here, for Pete's sake. You know, like, there would be this thing inside of her mind that says, no, I give him back all the days of his life. No, I'm like, he's going to be at home. He's going to be a mama's boy. And this would have been just the simple love a mother would have for the child. But also, I was thinking this might go around in her brain simply to have him as like a healthy version of like this trophy son, to where when all of her enemies and whether the culture, the neighbors, you know, brought that ridicule for being barren, she could just point to her son, well, look, I'm not cursed by God. It isn't some secret sin that you guys keep, you know, throwing on me. And she could just use her son necessarily as proof. That wouldn't be the only reason. It would have been to have a loving relationship with him, but it would have just been this shield, this defense against shame and reproach and all this pressure that was thrown on her. And so that would have been like the very natural inclination of like a woman in her shoes. I wouldn't have like held it against her if that was part of her prayer, if that was her decision. It would have been totally normal, but that's not what she does. She says, Lord, if you give me a son, I'm going to give him back to you. And so it is a very selfless prayer request. And notice how sincere and serious it says in verse 11, talks about how no razor shall ever go onto his head. And so this is just a very casual way of saying that he is going to be a Nazirite. He's going to be taking this Nazirite vow from his birth and for the rest of his life. You can go back to the book of Numbers, chapter 6, and it talks about this Nazirite vow. And even when God instituted the Nazirite vow, it was meant to be something that was just going to be temporary. And what you would do is you would take this Nazirite vow if you wanted a time to focus on discipline and holiness, and you really just wanted a time where you were, it wasn't even necessarily trying to pull something from God and like have him answer your prayers, but it was like, hey, I just from this pure spot of my heart, I want to set myself apart even more. We're already a nation set apart for God, but even in my own personal life, I want to dedicate this X amount of time for the Lord. And during that time, there was pretty much only three rules you had to obey. There was no fermented drinks, and that which also like would even include just grape juice. So like you couldn't have grapes, you couldn't have raisins, and I don't know why you would want to, but like I read, you wouldn't even be able to eat grape seeds. Like, who just eats grape? Like, have you seen the grapes? You know, they're like tiny. Like, who harvests grape seeds? But I don't know. That's a thing. But the Nazirite couldn't cut his own hair, his or her hair, for the duration of the vow. And you couldn't go near dead bodies or, like, grave sites or even of your own family. It was just during this small period of time, however long that individual set, that's how long the Nazirite vow would go. But it was just for that particular period of time to be disciplined and devoted to godliness. And so even like when the vow was over, there was a special ceremony that you go through. And so all of this kind of showed how it was very sincere and heartfelt and, you know, very ritualistic, but it was always meant to be just kind of temporary. But here, Hannah's like taking it to a whole new level. And she's like, no, this boy will be a Nazirite for his whole entire life. This is unique. And there's actually only two other people in all of Scripture where we actually read of this. It's Samson and John the Baptist. And so other than that, we don't know of anybody who has ever done this. And so really what I see out of this is she's emphasizing the fact she does want a son for her own sake, which I think is, again, super normal, but she ultimately only wants a son for the glory of God. That's where her heart is at. She's still focusing on God's will and for him to be magnified in this. And we see this humility not only in this particular vow of giving him back to him, but even as in her own, like, the title she's giving in this submissive title, this posture of humility, where if you count it up, she calls herself the Lord's handmaid 5 times. And so it really is speaking to her submissiveness. God, I just really want to please you. Like, I really hope you give this to me, but if it's going to be pleasing in your sight, then I want this. If this isn't pleasing in your sight, then she's ultimately saying, then just don't give it to me. Like, of course she wants it, but she wants what God wants more. And I couldn't help but think about our motivation when we're asking God for things. Like, when we pray, do we only pray for things because we want to get our will done? And when we pray, is it just simply for our own benefit? Which, those things in and of themselves aren't necessarily wrong. I mean, why else would we be praying? Because we want it, right? But there has to be the element attached to it. Like, what I'm seeing in Hannah here is, as she's praying, she still is going to say, but Lord, I'm going to be submissive to whatever your will is as I'm praying this. It has to be good for your glory. It has to be for you to be blessed by this, not just me. And that should be the heartbeat of everything. So you could be very sincere, as we'll kind of get into in just a moment. That's the next thing we'll look at, her prayer. You can be very heartfelt and very just fully dedicated and devoted to it. And there's nothing wrong with that. But it still has to, at the end of the day, say, but Lord, if you say no, I'm totally cool with this. That has to be our prayer. So let's kind of continue reading this story to see how it further plays out from 12 to 18, where it says, it came about as she continued praying before the Lord, that Eli was watching her mouth. As for Hannah, she was speaking in her heart, but only her lips were moving, but her voice was not heard. So Eli thought she was drunk. Then Eli said to her, how long will you make yourself drunk? Put away your wine from you. But Hannah replied, no, my Lord, I'm a woman oppressed in spirit. I have drunk neither wine nor strong drink, but I've poured out my soul before the Lord. Do not consider your maidservant as a worthless woman, for I have spoken until now out of my great concern and provocation. Verse 17, then Eli answered and said, well, go in peace, and may the God of Israel grant your petition that you have asked of him. And she said, let your maidservant find favor in your sight. So the woman went her way and ate, and her face was no longer sad. And so when you look at verse 13, and it talks about she's praying, and her lips are moving, but there's no sound coming out. One commentary pointed out how in that culture, when you went to the tabernacle to pray, that would have been kind of like out of the ordinary. They were just talking about that nearly all of the prayers would have just been prayed out loud, whether it was in a sense of a way of expressing yourself and making yourself audibly heard to the Lord and to others. But regardless of the exact reason of why they're doing it that way, that was just the common thing. And I even thought of, like, when I've been to Israel, I remember going down to the Western Wall, and basically it's like the closest place you can get in Israel to where, like, the Holy of Holies would have been back in the day. So that's all the Jews are permitted to get to. It's like right up there on that wall. And it's just like, it's always packed, and you see people of all sorts of types, but you typically, what I notice a lot is the Orthodox Jews are there, and they're either standing or they're kneeling or they're like rocking back and forth with their little prayer books and stuff. And just as much as my memory could serve me, I always heard them praying. And some of them would be really, really loud and boisterous, but some of them were just like just mumbling unto themselves. And it was never like a silent thing. There was even a particular tunnel. I don't remember the name of the tunnel, but it was kind of like right under that area. It's like something, Tunnel of David. If you've been there, it's not Hezekiah's Tunnel, which is also cool. But this is a different tunnel, and I can't remember the name of it. But it's like it's considered like a sacred, holy site. And when you're down there, they even tell you, like, hey, when you're in here, just try to be kind of quiet. Like, it's meant to be kind of quiet. So we're down there, but then you see people just hanging out there, like the Jews with their prayer books, rocking back and forth. And even then, they're mumbling under their breath. So they're being quiet, but they're praying, but they can't just pray in silence for whatever reason. You know, it's just like it's not in their DNA. And so as I read this commentary that's saying, you know, prayer at the tabernacle was usually audible, it kind of makes sense. I get that. So maybe that's the expectation, but it's not like a rule. It's not like every single situation ever. There's never a person praying just under their breath in silence. But because that's what Hannah's doing. And so when we read Eli was watching her mouth, he's judging her incorrectly and just kind of assumes that she's drunk. It is maybe a little bit out of the ordinary, but it doesn't automatically mean that she's drunk. And it's possibly the beginning of Eli showing how he's maybe slacking in some of these duties as a priest. He should have been a little bit more sensitive. He should have been more compassionate and having like more discernment on her. Just assume that she's in earnest prayer instead of being in drunkenness. He could have been sensitive to what her need is and how to come alongside and minister to her rather than like, oh man, put your wine away from you, you crazy drunkard. What are you doing? This, that, or the other. He just immediately is pessimistic and condemning towards her when his heart should have been full of compassion and moved by the Spirit of God as the high priest to minister. And so later on, we will see Eli get rebuked for not dealing with his sons well. And then even a little bit later on after that, we're going to see like the favor of the Lord and like God predominantly using Eli gets switched over to where he's going to start to use Samuel instead. And so what I think, a little picture of what we're even getting right now is just this precursor to the, he's on a slippery slope. He's on a downhill slide for the worst. And I think that's maybe what we're seeing here. And I like how Hannah just replies in humility here. She says, no, I'm not drunk. I'm just in serious prayer. And she uses like an idiom here, which is really neat. And her expression as she's talking about, no, I don't have any of this wine or strong drink. She says, I've poured out my soul to the Lord. And so it's that word picture to, it's like, I haven't been pouring myself drink after drink after drink. If there's anything that's being poured out, it's my heart. My very soul is being poured out to God. And so it's actually the opposite of what would be particularly bad is just pouring out drink after drink. Is something's very good and sincere and heartfelt. And she's just saying how serious this prayer is. It's a great visual to see that. And I'm curious, I'm sure a handful, maybe all of us in this room can maybe relate to that kind of a prayer. You know, there is a time and a place for just casual prayers, but I'm sure you've been hurt by something or just frustrated with something. And, you know, maybe you're on your knees, you're begging and you're pleading and you're crying because you've just been burdened by this, whether it's for you or for somebody else. And you're like, you know what, Hannah, I'm right there with you. I've been there and I've done that. And I wouldn't want anybody to think I'm just drunk when I'm just like, my heart is just being poured out before the Lord. And some of us may say, oh, I've never prayed like that. That seems kind of fanatical. That seems kind of weird. Like, what's up with that? And I would just want to encourage us that prayers can be casual or heartfelt. I think that there is a danger because I've seen people pray like this just for like attention. Right? And they want to be viewed as like some hyper-spiritual prayer warrior kind of a thing. And it is possible to have a lot of like sincerity and loud, boisterous, this, that, or the other, just for the sake of, you know, people, you know, having the attention on you. But then I've also had friends in Bible college, we're having prayer meetings, and he just, you know, looks down upon people who would pray, you know, at anything what he would consider long or repetitive or passionate, because it's like, oh, that's just a fanatical, and you just don't trust God. Like, all you have to do is ask him one time, and if you just ask him one time, that's good enough. And he just leaves the prayer meeting. He's like, I ain't got time for this. And I'm just like, what in the world? Like, judgmental much? Like, I don't get that. So there are people on all sides of this, and so I think that this kind of prayer does show a level of humility and trust and dependence on God. And so I would say what Hannah's doing is very, very acceptable. And there may be a time in your life where this is the appropriate thing to do. And I would encourage you to not hold that in and let it be like this in reserve. Because that's just kind of, if I'm just being honest about my own personality, I tend to hold those things in. Even in my own prayers with God, God knows the depths of my heart, what I'm struggling with. But it's not that I pray any sincere, but I still try to put like a tough act on. It's like, oh, Lord, you know, I got this, you know, and I'm just praying. And when really my heart may be shattered in that moment, and it's okay to be shattered. If your heart doesn't lead you to pray that way, don't force it. But the bottom line is I would encourage us to see Hannah as a good model here in saying there is a time and a place for this picture of just pouring out our soul before God. And so I would encourage you in that. And she says in verse 16, don't consider me a worthless woman. Well, I think there's something in here where there's an interesting connection here to the spiritual decline that we kind of talked about with Eli, is because when she says, do not consider me a worthless woman, in the original Hebrew, she says, do not consider me a daughter of Belial. And a daughter of Belial is what's known as a Hebraism. Just, it's a common expression in that Hebrew tongue, which they would have understood, as there's no real person named Belial who is someone, a daughter or a son of Belial. It's just very, it's an expression that implies being worthless. And that's why in the English, it's just kind of, it gets translated for us automatically, because we don't know who Belial is, but we know what it means to be worthless. And so the connection here is she's saying, hey, don't consider me a daughter of Belial. But then you fast forward to, what is it, chapter 2, verse 12, and it says the sons of Eli were worthless men. And in the Hebrew, it says the sons of Eli were sons of Belial. And so it's like, oh, interesting how there's definitely a parallel here, because Eli is mistakenly looking down upon Hannah, that, oh, yeah, she's just this daughter of Belial, when all reality, he should have been looking at his own sons and correcting and rebuking his own sons for being sons of Belial, for this worthlessness. So we're meant to see this subtle hint of irony here. And it's just unfortunate that he doesn't see that in his sons, and he never apologizes to Hannah for maybe the way he judged her and started treating her. But at least something that's a little bit good in here is that once he hears her response, he takes her serious, and he changes his attitude towards her. And instead of further rebuking her, he actually sends her away with a blessing. You notice in verse 17, hey, may God grant your petition. And when he says, may God grant your petition, this isn't, you know, Eli having some extra spiritual authority bestowed upon him where he can just start making executive decisions. Okay, well, now you get to bear children because I've pronounced this blessing on you, you know. That's not what he's doing. If anything, the closest thing I could say this might be is like God giving him just a word of prophecy. He's just more so wishing her the best and hoping her prayers would come true. But he himself couldn't just give this to her. And then when he says, go in peace, this isn't like him trying to calm her down by any means and just saying, hey, get out of here, just be peaceful. That was just a very common expression of farewell. And so Eli gives this blessing as she leaves. I like that there's even a change in her attitude. Because you notice in verse 18, it says, then she actually she went and ate. And we talked about how last week, how she, there's no matter how much people try to comfort her, she's like, I just can't eat right now. It's not in it. And it even said specifically she was no longer sad. So after speaking with Eli, God uses this encounter with her to lift up her face, to lift up her countenance. And she leaves more confident in the Lord than before she talked to him. And I think that's what we're meant to see. I don't think that she had this conversation with Eli and that she has all of this extra trust, like in Eli's authority in particular. Like, oh, great. You know, I went and talked to the priest. And, oh, I went and talked to the pastor. Because, you know, that happens a lot. It's like, oh, like I need prayer, but I only need the pastor to pray for me. I only need the priest to pray for me. And there's someone who I won't name by name because they may watch this one day, but they're saying, like, basically, oh, I know when that person prays, it's all the more powerful because that person's a pastor. And I've been around that person, and I've listened to his prayers, and, you know, they do. Yeah, he's very eloquent with his words, and I get it. You know, I would assume, I could see why someone's mind may go there. Like, oh, yeah, there's just a, there's this tone in your voice, and there's like, you quote so many scriptures, and this, that, or the other, and you can get drawn to how a particular man or woman prays. But what I really, truly believe is that her faith is now stronger in the Lord because of what Eli had poured into her. And so she's leaving more stoked on what God is going to do for her, not just because she had this encounter with Eli. So the perspective has to be right. We go to our brothers and sisters, but it's to be strengthened in the Lord. And so here's just a handful of scriptures, just four, about being strengthened by our brothers and sisters in Christ. Like Proverbs talks about sharpening one another. In the book of Hebrews, it talks about encouraging one another. I like 2 Corinthians, it talks about comforting one another in our troubles. And then in 1 Thessalonians, it talked about encouraging, but also building one another up. So where there's the sharpening, there's the encouraging, there's the comforting, there's the building one another up. This is what we should be doing to each other. This is what Eli is doing for Hannah. But at the end of the day, too, when we walk away from this, we don't think that the other person is all that great. We just like, hey, how the Lord used that person, and my eyes are set on God. And that's what we should be doing to making sure that their eyes are set on the Lord. If we're sharpening and encouraging each other, it's to have people have this right perspective with Jesus. And so she hears the blessing, she walks away encouraged, and let's see what happens next. Verse 19, it says, they arose early in the morning, and they worshiped before the Lord, and returned again to her house in Ramah. And Elkanah had relations with Hannah, his wife, and the Lord remembered her. It came about in due time after Hannah had conceived that she gave birth to a son, and she named him Samuel, saying, because I've asked him of the Lord. And so God remembered her again. So this wasn't Samuel's, this wasn't Eli's doing, this was God's doing. And so she has the child and names him Samuel. Samuel is basically a compound word of Shema and El. Shema means like to hear, and El is just like one way that we say God. So you could say that Samuel's name is like God has heard. And then when she says that, she says, yeah, I've named him this because I've asked him of the Lord. So basically, she asked, God heard it, and then said yes. And so she's just so moved with gratitude. That's why she says, I'm going to name him Samuel. It's pretty practical, and I get it. But it's a way of honoring God. In a sense, that's kind of how I named our son Jaden. I looked it up, and there's a few different things of what Jaden really means. But it's one of the definitions is the Lord had heard. And I was praying for a boy. I'm like, Lord, if you're going to give us a kid, I just really want to be a boy. I want my first child to be a boy. Ellie's giving me the stank face right now. I did want girls too, but I wanted my first child to be a boy. And so when we found out it was a boy, I'm like, yeah, sweet, you know. And so I felt like just almost like Samuel, God has heard this, and he's answered it, you know. And so sure enough, it's just a way to give God the glory for it. So that's what she does. And then in verse 21, the man Elkanah went up with all of his household to offer to the Lord the yearly sacrifice and pay his vow. But Hannah did not go up, for she said to her husband, I will not go up until the child is weaned, and then I will bring him, that he may appear before the Lord and then stay there forever. And Elkanah, her husband, said to her, do what seems best to you. Remain until you have weaned him. Only may the Lord confirm his word. So the woman remained and nursed her son until she weaned him. Now, when she had weaned him, she took him up with her with a three-year-old bull and one ephah of flour and a jug of wine and brought him to the house of the Lord in Shiloh, although the child was young. Verse 25, they slaughtered the bull and brought the boy to Eli. She said, oh, my Lord, as your soul lives, my Lord, I am the woman who stood here beside you praying to the Lord. For this boy I prayed, and the Lord has given me my petition which I have asked. So I've also dedicated him to the Lord. As long as he lives, he is dedicated to the Lord, and he worshiped the Lord there. So this first set around, you know, Elkanah goes back down, and Hannah doesn't make this journey, not because it was too difficult. We read it's because the child wasn't weaned yet. And so I was looking into this, and a lot of it has to do with like maybe some rabbinic tradition of what they considered, well, what really is weaning? And you could be anywhere from like, I guess, 18 months to like 5 years old when a mother had decided my child is now weaned. And so, I mean, it's hard to say how old Samuel was. The commentaries I read that they assume he's a bit closer to the five-year-old mark. And so maybe we could picture a little five-year-old Samuel there getting dropped off. And now it's like, you are now going to live here. And you are going to work here. And you're going to grow up. This is going to be your new home. Interesting. So this is like the final thing we're seeing in chapter 1. He's dedicated after he's born. Verses 24 through 25 specifically is like her bringing them to Shiloh. And then that sacrifice is just, it's an act of worship. And this is the time where she kind of just reminds him like, hey, this may be a surprise to you. I'm just dropping off a kid, but we had this conversation already. It's like, you're the one who told me the Lord was going to answer this prayer and that he was going to be dedicated to the Lord all the days of his life. And you said, yes, the Lord go be with you. And so here we go. Now he's yours in a sense. And so that's just really the chapter ending of how she drops him off. And now into chapter 2, where we're going to get into Eli and his family like kind of preparing to leave. And Hannah's going to get into just singing a wonderful song, a wonderful prayer. It's a heart of thanksgiving, really, is what this is going to be. And so before we get into that, I do want to just show you one quick slide that goes over like the outline of chapter 2. You can either just look at this now. I'll show it again next week. You can take a picture of it, because I encourage you to read chapter 2 ahead of time so you know what we're going to get into, because we're only going to read this first part this morning of Hannah's heartfelt praise. But then the problem with the priest and the promise of blessings, him confronting his sons, the prophecy of Eli, we'll cover that next week. Maybe even creep into chapter 3. Haven't decided just yet. Obviously, it's going to have to take it week by week, but that will be my goal, like I said, to cover one full chapter at a time. So kind of doing that today, half of this. I don't really know how it's going to work, but we will catch up eventually. But even with this outline, what I want to do is even break down that first section of Hannah's heartfelt praise. You can kind of break that down into four sections. That's kind of how I just want to tackle her prayer how I want to tackle her song is to look at the four different things that she highlights in this prayer. And we'll close with this. So the very first part of her prayer is, like, quote-unquote, titled the Lord's Salvation. And we see this in the first two verses. So that's the theme of these two verses, the Lord's Salvation. The Hannah prayed and said, "My heart exalts in the Lord. My horn is exalted in the Lord. My mouth speaks boldly against my enemies. Because I rejoiced in your salvation, there was no one holy like the Lord. Indeed, there is no one besides you, nor there is any rock like our God." And so there's some symbolism going on here, because when she talks about her horn as being exalted, that was just very common in that day. The horn was a picture of strength. And so when you would use, it was just basically synonymous. It was interchangeable here. So this strength, power, she's talking about how God has strengthened her to be able to speak up and have victory over her enemies, because her enemy is, this is probably a direct correlation to Peninnah, who was constantly bombarding her and, you know, saying she was worthless and all this stuff and all the things that maybe we didn't get the exact words, but all this pressure and all this heat and all this mockery that she had to endure, God strengthened her through this. And so she's clearly directing all the credit and all the glory to God of strengthening her, letting her overcome, being her defender. And so then, which rolls into this next part of God, you know, giving her, she gives God the glory for strengthening her. And then the second part is the Lord's humbling. This is verse 3 through the middle of verse 8 or so, where here she says, "Boast no more so very proudly. Do not let arrogance come out of your mouth. For the Lord is a God of knowledge, and with him actions are weighed. The bows of the mighty are shattered, but the feeble gird on strength. Those who were full hired themselves out for bread, but those who were hungry ceased to hunger. Even the barren gives birth to seven, but she who has many children languishes. The Lord kills and makes alive. He brings down to Sheol and raises up. The Lord makes poor and rich. He brings low, and he also exalts. He raises the poor from the dust, and he lifts the needy from the ash heap to make them sit with nobles and inherit a seat of honor." And so there's just a theme here of what she's talking about is God choosing to exalt those who are humble and God choosing to put down those who are proud. And so she just kind of, in a sense, says the same thing in various ways. That's just her expression over and over and over again. And if you look at verse 3 in particular, that's probably her referring to Peninnah again. You know, boast no more so very proudly. And so that may be a direct reference to all this boasting that was hitting her from her husband's other wife. But then she kind of breaks out and speaks about people in general in verses 4 through 8. The prideful person is going to be humbled and all that stuff. And I just wanted to take a moment on this because this could look in different ways, right? I think there's maybe one of the ways of we see pride right off the bat is some people are just very blatantly arrogant. And maybe they're just loud with it. They're in your face about how their pride. And that's an easy one to spot. But others maybe seem pretty humble on the outside, but there's a lot of pride still in their heart. And I would say that these scriptures do apply in both scenarios, right? God knows all of them, the blatant ones and the secret ones. And the scripture reminds us that sooner or later, God is going to humble that pride within us. He's going to pass a level of judgment on our pride to correct us, especially in the believer's life. We are to be marked with humility. And so the Lord will discipline us, even if we're hiding this secret kind of pride in our hearts. And if we just give this facade of humility, God wants it to be genuine humility. And so that's what we should be striving after. And so I think a good application to take away from this is just being aware of the fact that God is not going to just hold us accountable to the actions that we're doing, but also the heart behind our actions. I mean, she says a lot from verse 3 down to verse 8, like the most of her little prayer of thanksgiving here has to do with humility. And so I think God would even be using this in a way to stress to us the importance of humility in our lives. And so as we go about, we want to, obviously, we're not going to just, well, I mean, we might do it because we just don't care, but that extravagant, overt pride sometimes comes out and people don't care. But if we know we're going to avoid that, we also want to make sure what the part that God sees, far beyond the part that people sees, God sees the inner parts of our heart that we also want to keep in check and make sure our attitude is pure in it as well. So, like, are we doing it in humility for the sake of the glory of God? Or are we doing it in pride for our own motivation or for people to look at us? That's kind of how I was breaking that down. A good cross-reference would be Proverbs 16:18. where we're also further warned that pride goes before destruction and a haughty spirit goes before stumbling. And then James 4:10 is like kind of the opposite of that, where he says, hey, humble yourselves in the presence of the Lord and he will exalt you. And so, again, we could probably go through a handful of other scriptures too, to where if there's anything Hannah would highlight that I want to just kind of pull out of some other scriptures of how important humility is to the Lord. And so now we've seen the Lord's salvation, we've seen the Lord's humbling, and now this last part, or this third part, I should say, is the Lord's stability here. And so we'll go from the middle of 8 just through 9, where she mentions, hey, the pillars of the earth are the Lord's, and then he sets the worlds on them. He keeps the feet of his godly ones, but then the wicked ones are silenced in darkness, for not by might shall man prevail. And so the pillars are strong structures meant to support something. And there's this picture that comes out of God setting the pillars to support the earth. And in a similar way, God is the strength of the ones who to support of his godly ones. So along those lines of like people who are walking in humility, people who are walking in righteousness, people who are set about they wanting God's will above their own, God is going to always showing himself as their stabilizer. And so he can bring stability to our lives as well. And, you know, when we think of, you know, the things that rock our stability, it's usually circumstances. It's usually our emotions. It's things like these outward pressures that come in to make us feel unstable. And very quickly, our life may come unstable. And Hannah knew that. She had a lot of instability in her life from being barren and Peninnah and all the other people. So there was a time and a season where her life is marked by stability, but she clung to the Lord, and she's crying out to him, and God comforted her, supported her, and then stabilized her. And so now she's able to look back and just see, oh, look at Samuel here is proof that God has been with me, and in God's timing, he chose to stabilize me. And so just that time of testing in her heart, God got her through that, but eventually he got her to this stabilizing point. And so that was strong for her. It'll be strong for us. I even think back to the previous chapter of crying at the tabernacle, pleading with God. Eli thought she was a hot mess, just like super drunk, right? And he's like already condemning her. There's some more outside instability from the priest, from the religious leaders. But she left the tabernacle with a smile on her face. Even though she didn't have her son yet, God met her with some stability. So we don't even have to have Samuel born. We don't have to have some kind of tangible manifestation of God's promise in our life in order for us to be stable. Because Hannah was able to find that stability even just from the word of God. And so there will be things where God works in very tangible ways, and that obviously will bring an extra sense of stability. But we shouldn't need those tangible things in order to have that stability. And so Hannah is giving that praise and that thanksgiving to say, hey, start to be stable even before that promise of God gets fulfilled. Just trust in him before it happens. You know, be praying and singing about these things anyway. And then this final section, verse 10, is about the Lord's judgment, where she says, those who contend with the Lord will be shattered. Against them he will thunder in the heavens, and the Lord will judge the ends of the earth. He will give strength to his king, and he will exalt the horn of his anointed. And so at this point, she's kind of even looking further down the line of how there is going to come a coming day where God is going to judge the wicked. And I'm probably going to keep in mind, Hannah was being ridiculed and mocked by Peninnah, and so there's probably an element in her mind where she's like, yeah, even Peninnah, she's going to be judged. God's going to judge everybody. He's going to hold everybody accountable. And there's probably a finger pointing over there towards Peninnah. Because if you think back to in chapter 1, I think we talked about this last week, how the original Hebrew said Peninnah thundered against Hannah. Well, this is that same part where if you look it up, it says that, where is it at? That the Lord will thunder against his enemies. That's the very literal rendition here. And so there's this element where she's saying, God's going to judge and I don't have to judge. Vengeance is mine, says the Lord. And she's able to be content with that. She could have taken her own vengeance against Peninnah if she wanted to somehow, some way. But all that torment that she received, she just puts it into the Lord's hands. And I would say for us as an application, as Christians, that doesn't mean we can't ever defend ourselves. There will be a time and a place where God tells us to defend ourselves. But not every hill is worth dying on. And this is Hannah reminding us, hey, like the Lord will thunder. Like I don't need to be lightning and thunder all the time. God's thunder will be a lot stronger and give better retribution than I could ever give anyway. And in my mind, I'm always like, well, Lord, I want my you know, vengeance now, like, or you could have done this for me last week. But there's an element of this trust and submission to where she's saying, God, you will do this. It will happen eventually, and I could rest in that. And I did find it interesting that Hannah's talking about a king there already in verse 10. And right there, it's he will give strength to his king. And so they haven't even had a king yet. So I think there's an element in here where God is stirring her up with an element of prophecy to where she's speaking not just towards who Samuel, her son, is going to eventually anoint as a king one day, but it's a prophecy about the Messiah. Acts chapter 10 and 2 Timothy both talk about how Jesus will judge the living and the dead. So Jesus is our King of Kings. He is our Lord of Lords. And so I really do see that Hannah talking about God the Father fighting our battles, but there's a prophetical element of pointing forward to Jesus being king over the whole universe. And so we even see Christ right here, all the way back in 1 Samuel chapter 2. And so I'm going to just maybe close on this last little note, kind of about this humility. Yeah, Caleb, why don't you come on up? Well, I guess the whole, you want to come, you are you singing a song here? It's the last one. I'm not used to seeing Caroline up here with the band, which is, it's been pretty neat. But, hey, sorry about it. No. Hannah made sure to leave room for the Lord, right? And I just kept thinking, we're all going through stuff, and I'm sure that someone is sitting here tonight just feeling like someone's already offended you, and you're probably 100% in the right to feel like you've been offended, like someone very wrongfully has offended you. And there's that righteous part of us that says, hey, if I just say this or if I do this action, I'm justified in taking my own vengeance. And to some degree, I'd say, well, you know, you're probably right. But I just, after going through these scriptures tonight, I just think a special word for you tonight. Maybe this is not a hill that you're supposed to die on tonight. Whatever it is that someone's come up and you really want retribution on them, just as God was Hannah's defender, let's just go this week and just with the reassurance that God is still our defender. And, you know, there may come a time where God puts it on your heart to where, no, you do need to speak up. You do need to, you know, seek outside help and, you know, take a stand for yourself. And like I said, we aren't to be doormats where we just allow people to use us and abuse us and all that stuff. But man, I kind of saw this theme a little bit even last week as we looked at just Peninnah just abusing Hannah in a way. And so even though you're like me and you probably wanted to defend yourself already, I'm going to reflect on Hannah's prayer and just encourage us all to trust God's timing in this and trust that God is still sovereign and that he does these things. He strengthens, he stabilizes, he's a protector, and he defends, and like he will do that for us. And I don't seek extra counsel, seek extra wisdom about that to make sure that's how the Lord is applying it to your situation if you're in that. But it was just having my heart to want to encourage you that the Lord will take vengeance for you. So I just hope we can find peace and assurance that he'll bring that. Amen. Well, let's just close in prayer. Father, as we are looking at Samuel, and he's just a little boy at 5 years old maybe, but he's going to grow up real fast, and he's going to have some challenges along the way with some of the folly and the faults that we're already seeing in Eli, but we're also seeing really good example there of Hannah. Lord, I pray that you'd give us the discernment to take a lot of courage and find the ways that we could see the good examples in Samuel and the good examples of Hannah and apply them to our life and trust that that's the way in which you will sharpen us and to make us godly as well. And the things that we see in Eli and the things we see in his sons, Lord, let those be the warnings and let us clearly see of what to avoid, what path not to go down. Just because we see something being true in Scripture doesn't mean that we're supposed to implement it. And Father, I just trust that you will speak to us on a deep personal level to know how to respond back to you in these deep, intimate ways as individuals. But then these general applications that are just true for everybody, Lord, you know that each and every one of us is supposed to walk in humility. And so, Lord, may we have your exhortation not fall on deaf ears. Let it not go inside one ear and rot out the other, and we just kind of go about our days doing exactly as we were before. You are wanting to educate us. You are wanting to minister to us. And so may we hear it and not just be hearers only, but doers. And so we give you glory. We give you praise. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you guys.
Let's stand and sing some more worship.
How great the chasm that lay between us. How high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation, I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Out of the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadow of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken, the end is written. The King of Kings calls me his own. Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. His grip on me, you have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Then came the morning, the seal, the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, a roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me. Then came the morning, the seal, the promise. Your buried body began to breathe, and out of the a roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me. Oh, Jesus, yours is the victory. Oh, hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah, death has lost its grip on me. I've broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Oh, hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah, death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Jesus Christ, my living hope.
So this next song, I'm pretty sure is new, at least to this church. So if you don't know the lyrics, just kind of like close your eyes and just like accept the lyrics and just worship in spirit, because this is another just really, really powerful song about just building your life around Christ. It's called Firm Foundation.
Mm-hmm. Christ is my firm foundation, the rock on which I stand. When everything around me is shaken, I've never been more glad. I put my faith in Jesus, 'cause he's never let me down. He's faithful through generations, so why would he fail now? He won't. He won't. I've still got joy in chaos. I've got peace that makes no sense, so I won't be going under. I'm not held by my own strength, 'cause I've built my life on Jesus, 'cause he's never let me down. He's faithful in every season, so why would he fail now? He won't. He won't. Firm foundation, the rock on which I stand, and everything around me is shaken. I've never been more glad, 'cause I put my faith in Jesus, 'cause he's never let me down. He's faithful through generations, he won't. He won't fail. He won't fail.
He won't. He won't.
He won't fail. He won't. We're creation, suddenly articulate, with a thousand tongues to lift one cry. Then from north to south and east to west, we'd hear Christ be magnified. Oh, were the whole earth echoing his imminence, his name would burst from sea and sky, from rivers to the mountaintops. We'd hear Christ be magnified. And oh, Christ be magnified, let his praise arise. Christ be magnified in me. In all, Christ be magnified from the altar of my life. Christ be magnified in me. Oh, when every creature finds its inmost melody, every human heart is native cry, then in one enraptured hymn of praise, we'd sing Christ be magnified. Oh, in all, Christ be magnified, let his praise arise. Christ be magnified in me. Oh, Christ be magnified from the altar of my life. Christ be magnified in me. No, I won't bow to idols. I'll stand strong and worship you. If that puts me in the fire, then I'll rejoice cause you're there too. I won't be formed by feelings, I'll hold fast to what is true. And if the cross brings transformation, then I'll be crucified with you. Cause death is just a doorway into resurrection light. If I join you in your sufferings, then I'll join you when you rise. When you return in glory with all the angels and the saints, my heart will still be singing, my song will be the same. Oh, Christ be magnified, let his praise arise. Christ be magnified in me. Oh, Christ be magnified from the altar of my life. Christ be magnified in me. Sing it out to him. Oh, Christ be magnified, let his praise arise. Christ be magnified in me. Oh, Christ be magnified from the altar of my life. Christ be magnified in me.
Let's sing that chorus one more time all together and just bring an offering of worship before the Lord here.
Oh, Christ be magnified. Let his praise arise. Christ be magnified in me. And oh, Christ be magnified from from the altar of my life, Christ be magnified in me.
Lord, my prayer is that you will be magnified in this church, in Calvary, Windsor, Jesus. That people would look at us and see Jesus here, see the Holy Spirit moving, and know that there is a godly presence here that we are led by. Jesus, I pray in your great and holy name. Amen.